Hi, today we're going to talk about the input process output diagram to gain clarity into what's impacting your processes. So today I'm here through Lean Portland. It's a group of Lean Six Sigma professionals in Portland, Oregon that want to extend our expertise out into the community. You can join us through our happy hours, our free training like this, and our volunteer or pro bono consulting. You can check us out at leanportland.com or on our Eventbrite. A little bit about me, my name is Amanda Zimmerman. I'm a Lean Six Sigma Master Black Belt and also have my Master's of Business Administration. I spent about 10 years in Lean Six Sigma so far, and I was in oil and gas for about a dozen years. I spent 6 years in California before moving to Angola for 5 years and running Lean Six Sigma projects for an oil and gas company there. And I eventually came back to the US and Europe and did some consulting while earning my master's and eventually ended up in Portland working for a local nonprofit software company. I spent the last 6 months actually in the Antarctic working as a supply tech there, so supporting all the science that goes on down there. Today, what we're going to talk about is the input process output diagram. We're going to start off talking about what is an IPO, when and why to use an IPO, the relationship between the outputs and the inputs of your input process output diagram, and completing the IPO before discussing kind of what can you do now that you have this IPO. My focus today is to make sure that you can understand that relationship between the inputs and the outputs, that you can recognize process outputs and recognize process inputs. And if you want to learn any more about the tools we talked about, we're talking about the IPO, the CTQ, and the 6Ms. What is an IPO? So an IPO is simply a visualization of Y is a function of X. You are what you eat. You get what you're put in, right? So it's a simplified method for us to break down all these factors that will determine the success or failure of a given process. In this IPO I have down here, you can see I have arrows going in that are red, yellow, and blue, but the arrows coming out are orange and green, and they could be purple, right? Because all of these things have interacted, all these inputs have interacted to give us some kind of result or output. Why would this be an activity that you would want to do with your team? Well, it's an easy visualization. So it gives you actually something that is easy for people to take a look at and get a wide variety of information about your process from, which means that it makes it sometimes easier to communicate to management. It helps you to align values. So everybody's talking about outputs in the same way, understanding what measures are going to be most important. So you're getting that alignment of the team, and that helps you to kick off your measure and your analyze phase. This also gives you a strong foundation, whether you're doing a Lean Six Sigma project or not, to be able to all have the same perspective about a process, what the outputs of that process are, and what are the variables going into it that could affect that output. The thing I really enjoy about it in terms of a Lean Six Sigma project is it starts to open up that right side of the brain. It starts to get those creative juices flowing, and we're going to really need those when we move into our improve phase and our analyze phases. So if you are doing this as a Lean Six Sigma process or project, then I would do this really in the define phase. I generally do this for my Lean Six Sigma projects at the end of my define meeting. Now, if you're not doing this in Lean Six Sigma context, I would say you would do this activity when you wanted to have more understanding of your process performance, determining if there's some data that you want to be tracking to monitor that process performance. If you want to start thinking about what are root causes to some of the problems that I'm experiencing, or how could I identify some improvements to a particular process? And then I would always want to use this with a cross-functional team. So even if you weren't going to do more with it, if you were having an event where you had a cross-functional team, you might want to do this activity to help align them to that common view. So the IPO is made up of three parts. It's made of input, process, and output. When we're looking at processes, what we're talking about is a series of actions or steps taken in order to achieve a particular end. So quite often when we come together, we're talking about a problem. What we're going to do here is step back and talk about that process that we're using to achieve this particular end. So we're going to start, always, we're going to start with our process. We don't know what inputs are going to affect our outputs if we don't know what the process is that we're focused on. So the first thing that people generally jump to is the input, but we've got to slow that down. Let's start with the process that we're working on. So the process, we're going to start by understanding what's that process start and that process stop. Once we understand that, we're going to move to naming the process. So this is generally something that's going to be a verb and a noun. The noun is going to be that product or service that you're creating for your customer. The process or the verb is going to be that action that you're changing the product or service in some way. So how are you making this product or service some way improved or better, or passing it on to the next step as a result of this process? Now, just to give some background here, I'm a Lean Six Sigma Master Black Belt. This is the way that I use the IPO, but there are a variety of different ways that people use IPOs. And SIPOCs, or Supplier Input Process Output Customer diagrams, are very popular and common. So this is not the only way to do this activity. This is the way I teach it and the way I generally execute it with teams. I'm usually working with teams, though, that are not mature in their Lean Six Sigma journey. So this is a great tool to use for those teams because it's got that step up. So you can make it more robust, but this is a great starting point. So the example I like to use is this restaurant in 2014. They identified that they were having not as many people coming through the restaurant as they used to. So they seemed to have people still showing up, but they just couldn't turn over the tables as fast. If they looked at their Yelp or their TripAdvisor, what it said was that many of the restaurants in the area say the service was slow and that they needed to wait too long to get a table. So if we look at this in terms of our IPO, we're going to step back from that problem and talk about this process. So we're going to decide that the process is going to start when the customer is seated, and it's going to stop when the customer receives their food. We're going to call this process serving food. Make it simple. If you were doing one where you were changing a tire, you might say fixing a tire or changing a tire. If you were going to do one where you were serving an in-flight meal, so these are attending a webinar, presenting a webinar, all of those would be ways that you could define that process. Now we have our outputs. So now that we've decided or defined our process, we're going to move to those outputs, right? So that output is going to be the result that's produced from this process. Now, generally, I step back and I don't just say, what is that product or service? I actually want to see some measures associated with it. So on my output, I generally put things that you could use critical to quality metrics to be able to identify what these might be if you're having some challenges. If you can identify that product, maybe you can put that into requirements and identify a metric around that. This is a way that you can do that. I'm not going to spend a lot of time going into how to do CTQ, but if you wanted to, you could. So for example, if I was to say that I'm at a restaurant and serving lunch, my customers, what they want is a good lunch. I don't want it to take too long. I don't want it to be too hot. So a good lunch for me as a customer would mean less than 5 minutes to order and less than 5 minutes to get the food. The temperature I would want to be above 140 degrees. Now on my IPO, the way that I'm going to break this up is I'm going to look for at least one quality measure, at least one cost measure, time measure, and safety measure. So this is going to give me a nice balance for me to understand this process. So what I'm looking for is that there's a measure that is normalized some way. So I can take that data and I can actually put it onto a graph that I can see the direction of the improvement. So sometimes we put things on there, but we don't know, does the person want this to go up or do we want it to go down? So which direction do you want it to go? And then we're only going to identify a few of your metrics to delve into deeper, okay? So we're not going to try to boil the ocean. We're not going to get data on everything that you identify. We're going to identify as that cross-functional team which of those items you want to go deeper into. So just to refresh on our example of the problems that they are experiencing. So let's look at some of these output examples. So quality. So quality measures, we could look at something like Yelp review scores, number of orders sent back. For cost, we could look at something like average spend per customer. So you see that straight line there, that means that we want it to stay the same or we want it to go up, right? Now we could improve this process, right? We could get people in and out. We could make it a fast food restaurant, but now the spend goes way, way down. Right? So we want the average spend per customer to stay the same or go up. We want some visibility of that. We want the team to know that that's a goal. And then we want the number of customers served per day to go up, right? Minutes from seating to receiving the food. And for this one, we said number of fire code violations because it's a small restaurant and people keep trying to cram in there and it takes us over our number, right? So here's also for like safety and security, one of the things I get a lot of pushback on whether or not this should be on an IPO. These are really issues that could take down the entire process or organization. For us today, it might be more security-based depending on what your company is. Maybe it's more risk-based. Security comes up quite frequently when we're talking about personal information releases. So that's something that could be a safety or security metric that you could be looking at. If you noticed, I went ahead and highlighted two of these. So these are the ones that I'm actually going to go out and get more data on so that we can analyze that further. Maybe these other items, people on our team say, hey, the Yelp review score analytics are super easy to access. So I'm going to bring that data to us as well. So you can look at that in terms of ease and impact. If there's some easy data that you can bring to the table, awesome. But these are the two that we are going to monitor for the next 6 months or 3 months.